What are the pros and the cons of cruising with Oceania Cruises? I'm Gary Bembridge. This is another of my tips for travelers. I'm just back off another Oceania cruise, and I thought it was a great time to share with you what I think the pros and the cons of cruising with them are. So let's start, first of all, by taking a look at the pros. For me, one of the biggest pros is that they have small to medium-sized ships, and I really like that in a cruise line. So they have altogether at the time of recording, although they do have more on order, six ships. Four of those are what are known as the R-class ships. These were originally built for Renaissance cruises and bought by Oceania when they went bankrupt. So they have four ships, and these ships hold 698 passengers, so just under 700 passengers. The ships are the Regatta, the Nautica, the Insignia, and the Serena. They then do have two purpose-built ships specifically for them, and these carry 1,250 passengers, and those are the Riviera and the Marina. All of the ships have gone through a big program, which is called Oceania Next. They spent $100 million revamping and redoing all the ships to kind of get them up to a more luxurious and more contemporary look and feel. And they certainly did a great job with what I saw on my most recent cruise on Insignia. So Oceania is small to mid-sized ships, and that for me is a really big plus. The two new ships are going to be about the same size as the existing slightly larger ships. So it's going to have 1,200 guests, and they're coming into service over the next couple of years. The second big pro for me is the fact that they provide a luxury premium experience, but it's not very stuffy. So the whole experience is pretty relaxed, but it is definitely operating in the luxury premium area. So they probably compete with brands like Azamara, I would say, Windstar. So it's not the ultra luxury level, it's the more premium side, but smaller ships. So it is pretty relaxed. So the dress code is fairly relaxed. They have country casual as their overall umbrella thing in the evening. But in practice, I found people do tend to dress fairly relaxed. And certainly up in the buffet, you can go in shorts and wear your baseball cap if you want to in the evenings. So it's pretty informal from that perspective. Some people, of course, do get dressed up, particularly on the captain's welcome farewell party. But overall, the dress code is pretty relaxed. So if you're one of those people that like to really get glitzed and dressed up, you can, but you're probably going to be more of the exception. The service is very personal, it's very friendly, it's not very formal and stuffy like some of the luxury lines and premium lines can be. It's fairly informal, they get to know your name. And so the whole ambiance, the people on board, it's quite relaxed. So it's luxury, it's premium, but it's relaxed. So if you're looking for a slightly more relaxed experience, then definitely Oceania, I would say, is a pro for you. Most people would say that the biggest pro of Oceania, and I certainly think they believe it's their biggest pro based on the amount of effort they put against it, is food and the whole culinary experience. So, for example, they've actually trademarked the line Finest Cuisine at Sea, so that's how strongly they believe in it. They also, and I think this is true, certainly all the research I did seems to confirm it, they spend the most on food per passenger, certainly in the category. So there is a real big focus around food. The food, they have a relationship and a partnership with a celebrity chef who's actually French, but now based in the US. He used to actually be the chef for two or three of the French presidents, and his name is Jacques Pepin. On some of the bigger ships, they have a whole culinary center. They also have culinary-focused excursions. They have food and wine excursions. And during the course of the cruise, they'll also have special pairing dinners. They'll have various tastings of different types of drinks. So there's a really big focus around food and drinks. Certainly in the main dining room, the menu is enormous menu. Just, it's mind-bogglingly huge. The quality of the food, I would say, in the buffet restaurant is amongst the highest. The quality is really in the ingredients. So certainly if you are really into food and that really turns you on and it's important to your cruise, take a look at Oceania, because bear in mind they are on the premium luxury end, so they are not as expensive as some of the ultra luxury lines, but you're going to get a great experience. And certainly that's one of the things they would win most awards are in the area of food. Linked to that, for me, the fourth biggest pro of Oceania is the fact that so much of the dining experience is included within your fare. So on many of the other premium or luxury lines, you'll find that specialized dining is expensive, but all of that is included within your fare on Oceania, which is a real big plus. So let's take a look at what you actually get from a food perspective. And again, I'll perhaps use the example of Insignia, which I am just most recently off. So you have the grand dining room, breakfast, lunch, dinner most days, massive big menus, waiter service, incredible choice, really good food. You then have the Terrace Cafe Buffet, which I really like. It's hugely popular, and in the evenings they'll often have themed evenings. One of the big pluses is they have fantastic sushi at lunchtime, really, really great sushi, which is again included in the fare. You then have out on the pool deck, you have Wave Grill, which has sort of a healthy breakfast, and then actually at lunch they have the unhealthier side, so great hamburgers, hot dogs, that kind of stuff at lunchtime. So again, informal dining. They have afternoon tea about 4 o'clock every afternoon on Insignia, was up in Horizons. This is great traditional food served at your table with a trolley full of scones and cakes and sandwiches and all that kind of stuff, again included within the fare. Room service completely included within the fare, 24 hours a day. You also have baristas where you get your specialty coffee and snacks during the day. And I really like the fact that you do get specialty coffees and that's all included, as a big fan of coffee. In terms of specialty restaurants, there are slight differences between the smaller R-class ships like Insignia that I was on and the bigger ships like Riviera. So for example, on the Regatta, Insignia, Nautica, Serena, you have Toscana, which is the Italian restaurant with probably one of the biggest Italian menus I've ever seen. Really nice Italian food. And then they have Polo Grill, which is the steak house and the seafood restaurant. That was the one that people absolutely loved. And as I mentioned, that is included within the fare. Once you get onto the other ships, Marina Riviera, you've got Jacques, which is French. You've got Red Ginger, which is Asian, and Tuscan, which is their steakhouse. So specialty dining included, for me, a big pro. Another really big pro is, unlike even some of the premium and other luxury lines, much more is included within the fare. So that's a really big plus. So they have what's known as O-Life fares. And what O-Life fares normally include is they can include airfare. Of course, you can strip that out if you want. You, of course, get your usual things, accommodation and all the dining, as I've said. You also get Wi-Fi included. Now, it's basic Wi-Fi, and you can connect one device per room at a time. They do have a faster, more streaming service which is available, which costs at the time that I was cruising $9.99 a day, and certainly it was really good. I was able to do streaming, I was able to watch things on streaming, I was able to do FaceTime with home. Also within their life fares, you then get to choose one of three things. So you can either choose to have excursions, so there's a number of excursions included based on how long your cruise is. You can choose to have the house beverage package, or you can choose to have onboard credit. All those things are included within the fare. Now, there are some big watch outs and probably some cons to some of those things that I'll talk about in the cons section. But certainly there are much more things included within the fare. What's not included is excursions if you don't take the O-Life package, and gratuities are not included. Those are the two main on costs. And of course, if you haven't taken the beverage package, beverages are an on cost. So those are the key pros of Oceania. What about the cons? What do I think are the cons? The sort of the downsides of cruising on Oceania that you need to bear in mind as you decide if this is a cruise line for you. For me, the first key con is actually sort of the some of the downsides of the inclusions and the O-Life. So when you look at booking the fare, you do need to understand there are some limits to what's actually included. So although it sounds great that you might get excursions or you might get the house beverage package, there are some limitations. So let me run through those. First of all, the free internet, you can only connect one device at a time. So if there's two of you in the cabin and you want to be online at the same time, you do have to buy a second package, or you have to keep logging on and off. So that's important to bear in mind with the internet. If you buy the beverage package, it's the basic standard beverage package. So you only get your wines and beers included at mealtime, so lunch and dinner. So if you want to drink, you know, around the ship at any other time, you do have to pay for those. You can then upgrade to their more premium package, which at the time of recording was around about $20-$25 per person per day. And then you can have drinks any time of the day, whatever you want. And it's a pretty big, expansive program. So bearing that in mind if you're going for the beverage package. If you go for excursions, there are limitations. So for example, a 9-day cruise would have 4 excursions, but that's 4 excursions in total. So if there's two of you in a cabin and you're going on an excursion, there's only basically 2 sets of excursions because you're going to use up 2 of those 4 for one outing for the two of you. So that is important to bear in mind if you go for the excursion option. So what do? I actually go for the onboard credit option because the onboard credit I think is pretty generous. I had close to $400 for the cabin that I was in. And then you can then allocate that between drinks or excursions or cover gratuities if you wanted to use it for that. But certainly everyone I spoke to, they really liked and spoke about the O-Life fares, where you have a choice of what you want to include or exclude based on your preferences. So it is, there's some cons to it, but there's of course some big pros to it. The second con is really a function of the fact that it's a much smaller ship with less people. But I would say you don't go on an oceanic cruise for the entertainment. You go on for other things, the experience, the smaller ships, the food, the more casual environment. Entertainment is fine. There's not huge amounts of entertainment. So they do have the lounge where they'll have something on in the evenings. So they have a small troupe of singers who will perform various revue type shows. They will have some guest artists on board, but there's not a big, you know, you don't have big glitzy production shows, and it's definitely much lower key. Certainly they were extremely well attended. Maybe that's a function of the fact that it's not lots of entertainment on board, but the evening shows were packed out because I guess there's less options. The daily program is not a massive big daily program. There's normally going to be activities on, but again, it's fairly low key. So you might have table tennis competitions or deck games or crazy golf games. You might have the odd quiz going on, but there's not jam-packed full of activities. They do have a library on board, so you can go and get books out if you want to, but it is definitely a much lower key thing. So I would say if you're the sort of person that likes lots of entertainment and wants to be entertained rather than entertain yourself, definitely Oceania is more of a con from that perspective. On some of the bigger ships, they do have a culinary center where you can go on cooking classes, and you will of course have various cooking demonstrations on all of the ships at various times. One of the other things that they do have on the cruise in terms of entertainment is enrichment. So they had, for example, on the cruise I was on, they had Electra, who is very popular on board Oceania, and she gave talks pretty much every single day. And again, they were packed out. They're really busy, partly because I think people go on board are interested in enrichment. And again, also maybe because there's not lots of other choices I think to do. So people gravitate towards those sort of things. Possibly another con of cruising on Oceania is the dress code. The dress code is much more unpredictable. So on the cruise I was on, I found the level of dress code was probably a little bit on the smarter side, although it was casual. Other people who've been on the cruise before to me said it was much more, you know, casual overall. So if you are the sort of person that is really likes to get dolled up and dressed up, bear in mind you are not necessarily going to be surrounded by other people. So if you go on other cruise lines which have much stricter dress codes, then you're going to find that, you know, the style of dress is very different. So I put that as a con because I know some people really like the dressing up, some people don't like the dressing up. So it depends on where you're coming from. So for some people it's a con, for other people it's a massive big plus. The other con area or watcher that I want to talk about is who I think Oceania is for, because I think it is for a very specific type of person. So let me explain that in more detail. Most of the people you're going to find in Oceania are couples. They will largely sort of be 50, 60s and above, although you will find a good spattering of ages. So on my cruise, for example, and when I've been on Oceania before, there've been perhaps a multi-generational family with kids traveling probably in their early 20s. On my cruise, there was a couple of couples who were probably late 20s, early 30s. So it does get a diverse range, but the bulk of people are going to be 50s, 60s, 70s. Lots of Americans. It's a very popular American line, but on the cruise I was on, there was something like 20 different nationalities. So we had lots of Germans, we had lots of Danish, we had some UK, some Australians. So it is quite diverse, leaning a little bit more towards American. If you're a solo traveler, they don't have solo cabins. I actually went on my cruise as a solo traveler, but I was paying for dual occupancy of the cabin. So they don't have solo cabins. They do have some solo meetups, but it's not massively geared towards the solo travelers. So if you're very comfortable with that, paying that premium, and you like the idea of what Oceania offer with food, certainly I was made to feel very welcome on board by both the passengers and the crew. If you're a family, I don't think Oceania is for you. They don't have kids clubs, they don't have programs for kids, and it's not really geared towards kids at all. They do have some cabins where you can sleep three people, but it's not geared towards kids. There is one key exception, and that's in Alaska. So when the Oceania ships head to Alaska, they do have a Alaska Explorer Youth Program, which is targeted at kids between the ages of sort of 5 and 12. So that's the only key exception, but I don't think Oceania is really for families that don't have facilities. And actually, I don't think the passengers are looking for kids on board, because it's a much more adult experience. Oceania Cruises, I loved my time on Oceania Cruises. I had a great time. I liked the mix of high quality, being a little bit more relaxed, particularly if as I was doing in the Caribbean. I have loads more tips, videos about Oceania, the Caribbean, and cruising in general. So why don't you watch another one of those right now?